Sometimes we make amplifiers where the voltage gain is 1. Why would you want to do that? What's the point of having an amplifier if it's just going to replicate the signal from the input to the output? That's what we're going to talk about here in this video. Let's look at an example. Let's say that you have a small signal or a voltage VS that's very small, and all you want is for that same voltage to show up across a load resistor. Between the two blue dotted lines, I can insert an amplifier with a gain of 1. That would ensure that my source voltage makes it across to my load resistor, but you might be wondering, what's the point? Why would I want to do that? Before I answer that question, I'd just like to point out that one of the transistor configurations that we looked at in the last video, the common collector configuration, does exactly this. There it is. You might recall that it's a common collector configuration because it's the collector of this bipolar transistor that's not in the signal path. Our signal enters the transistor at the base and it exits at the emitter. The collector is not in the signal path, therefore it's called common collector. It turns out that for this particular configuration, the common collector configuration, the signal that enters the base is simply replicated at the emitter side. The voltage gain is 1. Again, what's the point? Why don't we just take the input and connect it with a wire to the output? Wouldn't that do the same job? Isn't a wire connecting input to the output having a voltage gain of 1? Well, no, and that's what I want to describe right now. Let's calculate the output voltage of this circuit if I just connect the source to the load with a simple wire. Then I'll show how that changes if we have an amplifier there instead. Let's call this our load voltage, and that's what we're interested in finding. It's going to be a voltage divider. The load voltage is going to be some fraction of the source voltage, and the fraction is related to the values of the load and source resistors. When we have an amplifier, what do we normally have, though, when we consider these resistances? You see, it takes more power to drive a small resistance load than it does to drive a high impedance load. If you're trying to apply a voltage, for example, across a 1 mega ohm resistor, that's a lot easier than applying the same voltage across a 1 ohm resistor because you have to pump a lot more current through the small resistor to maintain the same voltage than you would through a large resistor. Therefore, small load resistors tend to require amplifiers because they simply need more power to drive them. Whatever source you have in your circuit might not have enough power to drive small impedance loads. Now let's look at our equation again and draw a conclusion. In situations where we require an amplifier, the load resistor tends to be small. If it were large, we might not need an amplifier. On the other hand, when we're dealing with bad sources, that is, very weak sources that can't deliver very much power to start with, their source resistances tend to be large. If they were good sources, then they would have, ideally, 0 source resistance. So, in practical circuits, the source resistance tends to be larger than we hope. I'm saying large and small here, but everything's relative. The point is that this ratio is not normally equal to 1. It's equal to 1 in the case where you have a very good source, that is a small R sub S, and a very easy load to drive, that is a very large RL. So this is only equal to 1 in those more idealistic cases where you probably wouldn't need an amplifier. But if you look at realistic cases, this tends to be much smaller than 1, and that's why we need an amplifier. What does an amplifier do? Well, a good amplifier has a very large input impedance and a very small output impedance. Let's just assume that the output impedance is 0. Furthermore, for the purposes of our discussion, we could assume that the input impedance is infinite. All right, large there, but we'll think about it as if it's infinite. Let's now calculate our gain, keeping in mind that my amplifier here has a voltage gain of just 1. If my input impedance, Rin, is a really large number, then I'm not going to have any current or very, very small current passing through R sub S. This simply means that Vn equals Vs. At our output side, you can then see that our load voltage is just Vn. It just equals Vs. Therefore, my voltage at the load equals the voltage at the source. From the equation that we derived when I simply used a wire to connect the source to the load, and you can see that this case with an amplifier is better. It's better because the voltage gain of an amplifier doesn't tell the full story. What really matters in an amplifier is the power gain. And we might have a lot of power gain here if our load resistor is small. Maintaining the same voltage across the load resistor, if that load resistance is small, is much more difficult or requires a lot more power than the case if the load resistor is large. That brings us to the case of the common collector amplifier. What's it used for? Well, it's used mainly as a buffer. I can even now estimate my input and output impedances here. The input impedance looking into that amplifier through the dotted lines is going to be much larger than the impedance of our load resistor. That's why, although this configuration has a voltage gain of only one, it can have a much larger power gain. You can use it to drive loads, even if you only want to have the same voltage at the load as you have at the source. If I call these two resistors R1 and R2, then it turns out that the input impedance to this particular amplifier can be estimated as R1 in parallel with R2. So later when we design transistor amplifiers, we'll need to ensure that Rin, or R1 in parallel with R2, gives a value that's large compared to our load resistance. In that sense, the common collector amplifier will function as a buffer. Let's now say a few words about the output impedance of this amplifier. Now, we want the output impedance to be small. How small is small? Well, what I really care about is how small the output impedance is relative to my load resistance. Now, what determines the output impedance of this amplifier? I have two branches when I look back through the dotted lines. I have one branch going down through this resistor. I'll call it R sub E, and then I have another branch going up through the emitter of that transistor. So however I calculate the output impedance, it's going to be R E in parallel with whatever the resistance is looking up into the emitter of that transistor, and I don't yet have the techniques available to calculate that. We'll have to look at that in a future video, but for now, what I can do is estimate the worst case scenario for my output impedance. Recall that when you combine two resistors in parallel, the net resistance tends to be a smaller number. Therefore, the worst case output impedance is just going to be R sub E. You're never going to get an output impedance that's larger than R sub E, in other words. Although I've not derived it yet, I'm saying that the voltage gain of the transistor amplifier itself is just one. So what's the gain of the entire circuit? Well, it's going to be determined by the two voltage dividers. We have a voltage divider at the input side, and we have a voltage divider at the output side. I could draw an equivalent circuit. There's my input side. Now, by just writing Vin here, I'm implicitly assuming that my voltage gain is one. You'll have to take my word on that for now. And here's the output side. If I'm interested in knowing what my AC voltage gain is, I could calculate it by looking at this drawing. The small signal load voltage, or the AC load voltage, divided by the AC source voltage is merely these two voltage dividers. There's the first voltage divider, and there's the second voltage divider. Provided that my input impedance Rin is large relative to my Rs, and that my output impedance Rout is small relative to my load resistor, then this is going to be one. In other words, the common collector transistor configuration functions as a buffer.